Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Secret Rules to Being a Rock Star by Jessamyn Violet. Narrated by Amanda Dolan. I just want to feel everything. Fiona Apple. The Ground Rule. I fell in love with music like it was a person. From a very early age, I ate up anything a stereo speaker had to say and found something to appreciate in everything from pop hits to the most obscure genres and songs. The first thing I wanted to know about anyone I met was what kind of music they listened to, and the last thing I became hungry for before my life exploded was validation that the feeling was mutual, that music and I were in love with each other. Because I didn't just listen to music. While other kids my age flirted and fooled around with each other, I found my own version of making love. Fingering the chipped ivory keys of our ancient piano in the basement, while my voice entwined with the notes. I covered every song I loved and fantasized about being a professional musician. I cranked out original material like I might just die otherwise. Then I turned 18 and decided to play before an audience to see if it was really meant to be. And while Western Massachusetts wasn't exactly brimming with opportunities that matched my imagination's version of my onstage debut, it was my best and only option. It was time to start the grind from the ground up. Rule number one. Rock stars attract rock stars. My hometown of Northampton, Massachusetts, had just enough spice to taste like a small city. It wasn't a billboard and skyscraper kind of place, but it had its own little pockets of cool. Main Street was lined with record stores, cafes, bars, hippie shops, and eclectic little themed restaurants, like the one that happened to change my life, the Porch House. The old-timey barbecue shack had sagging steps that led up to oversized double doors. Inside, the uneven wooden picnic tables were decorated with rolls of paper towels and bottles of barbecue sauce. The floors were covered in sawdust, and there was enough taxidermy on display to make any animal lover shiver. The bar was one gigantic, polished slab of tree trunk, and the bartenders and servers wore ascots and hats, most likely against their preference. In the back corner was a dusty, upright piano, much like the one in my basement, except that it gave my songs a little twang, like a pedal effect that wasn't entirely wrong for the mood. Jenny and I were miraculously on time, even though she had made me change my outfit twice. Jenny always pushed me to take more fashion risks. Ugh, that word. Fashion. I hadn't wanted to perform in anything more than my usual t-shirt and jeans, but she pressed me to take myself seriously. Somehow that translated to more sparkles, and I ended up in her mirror-studded peasant skirt and bejeweled tank top. The outfit was embarrassing, but even worse was the fact that I kind of liked it. It made the show feel like more of a staged performance and less of an open exposure directly into my soul. The restaurant was warm, packed, and reeked of its familiar combination of wood smoke and beef. Except something felt different that night. There was a prickly pulse in the air, an electricity that hadn't been there before. I gave Jenny a look. After 10 years of friendship, we could easily communicate without words. "Right?" Jenny whispered. "That's called buzz, and you got it." "What I got is nerves," I grumbled. "What am I doing in this bohemian sparkle Barbie outfit?"
"Pulling it off," she said, grinning. "You know you love it." I shook my head and headed straight to the back of the dining floor, while keeping my eyes fixed on the piano, my life raft. I didn't want to recognize anyone. It was way easier playing to a room full of hypothetical strangers. A gigantic moose head with Christmas lights draped around its antlers hung on the wall above the piano. I gave him a little nod before I sat down. It seemed the respectful thing to do since he was stuck in such an unfortunate afterlife. The manager, Bob, a science teacher-looking type in a corduroy jacket and tweed pants, came over with a mug of hot chocolate, per my usual request. I sat down at the piano bench, cracked my knuckles, and gave him a nod. "Attention," Bob said as the lights dimmed and people started to shush. "May I have the honor of presenting Northampton High's own up-and-coming talent, Kyla Bell?" As applause warbled in my ears, I struggled to breathe. The time had come to crack myself open again, revealing my inner self to the crowd. Nothing to do but plunge in headfirst, lose my surroundings by disappearing deep into the songs. Playing was a form of time and space travel for me. The piano was my ship, transporting me to faraway soundscapes with the press of the keys. My voice loved to weave with the sound of thick strings being hammered into melodies. I burrowed deep into my songs to create cocoons of sound that kept me spinning in an orbit between light and darkness, hope and sadness. Performing was a particular kind of fix, and I was definitely hooked. After I finished, the clapping seemed to go on forever. I smiled so hard it started to hurt, and quickly sought refuge at the table Jenny had claimed in the corner. Bob sped over to us. "Your best set yet," he raved. "Dinner's on the house." He handed me a $20 bill and smiled shyly before rushing back into the kitchen. "Oh, yay," Jenny joked when he was gone. "Free terrible dinner." "You definitely burned up the place. Everyone's staring at us."
"Try not to look stupid."
I laughed, grateful for her humor, even though the truth was, I did feel I looked stupid. I always had the problem of not knowing how to look. I wasn't one of those people who practiced expressions in front of the mirror or anything, but for both our sakes, I tried to make my expression as blank and aloof as possible while savoring the sliver of pride I felt at how I had played. There was something burning into the back of my neck, though. I turned to notice a guy with long dark hair emitting a microwave magnetic stare at me from the table he shared with two other scruffy musician types. I looked away but could still feel him approaching.
"Hey."
I forced myself to look into his laser beam eyes. Jenny did a bad job stifling a giggle, and I cringed as he cleared his throat.
"Really dig your stuff,"
he continued, ignoring my paralysis. I stared at his stubble. Why did he look so familiar? He was definitely too old to be in school. "You had me hearing some cool guitar parts in my head. Your voice is so deep, and I'd call you punk if your songs weren't so smooth at the same time. Congratulations on creating your own sound. How long have you been playing?"
10 years, I said, hoping that was the end of it.
"Wow, since what age?"
So he was forcing it out of me. "I just turned 18.
He laughed. "That's what they all say." "Kidding. Oh, you're probably wondering who the creepy compliment guy is. I'm Brian Brighton, singer for..."
"Oh, totally. From Eyes Wander,"
I interrupted, dropping any little bit of cool I'd maybe had.
Yeah, we've heard of you guys."
"Ha, she's kidding," Jenny blurted out. "We listen to Thieving Dreams all the time." Her dimpled smile made her look more like a freshman than a senior. She could turn on the charm when she wanted to, though. Unlike me.
Awesome. So, Brian seemed to be making up his mind about something. Whatever it was, I hoped he'd figure it out before a large plate of smelly food was set in front of me. Jenny and I hated to eat in front of strangers. It was what we called totally unslick. Well, thanks for saying hi, I said with a note of finality. He looked across the room toward the other two guys sitting at his table. They were watching us in amusement. I wondered what kind of a joke we were to them. Or maybe they had some other plans for us, inviting us somewhere and putting the moves on us. The thought made me uneasy, and I suddenly wanted to get out of there. This scene wasn't normal for the porch house. We were usually forced to talk to a few gushy grown-ups before slipping out the side door and running down to the coffee shop to make fun of people and listen to whatever hip-hop DJ was spinning vinyl that night. Instead, here we were, stuck in this clumsy exchange. "That's the rest of the band," he said, gesturing at the other guys. "Of course," Jenny said smoothly, waving at them. I winced. They looked intimidating. Their coolness contrasted by the hokey restaurant backdrop. Why were they even at the porch house? Brian seemed to read my thoughts. "We always come here when we pass through. The drummer's got a taxidermy fetish. Been trying to buy that piece off the owner for years." He pointed, and I looked over at the stuffed mongoose above the bar, fastened to a log, cold marble eyes wide and teeth exposed. "Creepy fetish," I mumbled. "You should see the grizzly bear he has in his living room back in L.A., Brian responded. I laughed uneasily. "No, thanks." "So, will you two come join us?" I shook my head immediately, and Brian looked offended. "We gotta get going," I said with zero finesse.
"Well, at least come say goodbye before you leave, all right?"
I shrugged and nodded in a non-committal way, and we watched him walk back over to his table.
"What the hell was that?" Jenny hissed at me as soon as he was out of earshot. "What? We're supposed to go over there and hang out with eyes wander? I don't have anything interesting to say to them."
"So what? Make stuff up. Brian seems sweet. He's a dreamy singer, and he's obviously into you. What more can you ask for?"
I couldn't exactly argue with Jenny, but she didn't know how little I was into him. I had been faking enthusiasm about guys for years. I would pretend I adored famous frontmen and claim high school guys didn't interest me at all. That left me with absolutely no reason not to hang with the famous older, hot musicians in front of us. The reason presented itself as slabs of brisket and onions were set in front of us, a stinky, uncool nightmare. I wasn't hungry, nor would I even want to eat with a well-known band sitting behind us. I couldn't just bail, though. That might be considered rude enough to ruin my only gig in town. But Jenny always knew what to do. She asked the waiter to wrap it up to go immediately. He glared toward Brian.
"Was that guy harassing you?"
"No, not at all," Jenny said. I nodded in agreement.
He looked unconvinced, but took our plates away. When he returned with the takeout bag, we headed over to their table as casually as possible, which meant I bumped into at least three chairs.
"Hey, ladies," said one of Brian's bandmates, a surfer guy with bedhead hair and laughing eyes. "Sit down and join us."
"We can't," I said quickly. "We have to be somewhere." My every move screamed amateur hour to me. This night that had felt more special than any other had suddenly morphed into a bad sitcom. The girl who didn't know how to talk to guys, so her best friend ditched her episode. As if reading my mind, Jenny dug her fingers into my side. I stepped as far away from her as possible and shot her a help me out here look.
"You've got a cool vibe,"
the surfer guy said. I suddenly pinned him as the bassist for Eyes Wander. Calvin.
You yowl like a girl from the past stuck in modern times, trying to make sense of everything.
Oh, thanks, I said.
Don't mention it,
he said, pushing his hair around his face. I could tell he thought he was adorable. Jenny could tell that I needed a hand.
Where are you guys off to next?
My heroic partner in crime asked.
We're actually playing the Paradise tomorrow, Brian said. We've got Knives opening for us, sold out show.
Wow, Jenny and I said at the same time. I knew she didn't know who they were any more than I did, but she hit it a lot better.
Tommy, the taxidermy nut, who had clearly been in a lot of bar fights, started drumming on the table with two dinner knives.
We booked this Berkeley band to kick it off, but we just found out the lead singer has mono, so they're out.
That's too bad, I said.
What do you think about filling the slot?
So Brian wanted band suggestions. I don't know many Boston bands, I said. I'm not really in on that scene. The guys laughed. A heat wave of shame flooded through me. Jenny looked at me sympathetically, the worst of all looks you could get from Jenny.
We want Kyla Bell to open the show, Brian said.
Do you think she can?
Tommy stopped drumming with the knives and raised his eyebrows, challenging me. Shock hummed and thrummed through my veins, a whitewash of white noise, as what was happening slowly registered. Eyes Wander wanted me to open for them. They were in music magazines, toured internationally, sold out shows. I was a teenage piano player with a little backpack of unreleased songs. I'm not sure which face I was making, but judging by the way the guys were looking at me, my reaction was amusing. Well, I wasn't here for their amusement. I wasn't going to be the naive girl from the smokehouse who they'd both tricked and heartbroken in the span of 5 minutes.
You guys are joking, right? It's not very funny.
She's the one joking, Jenny said quickly. Right, Kyla?
No joke. Promise, Brian said.
I stared at him, incredulous.
So, are you in?
I remained skeptical. It really felt like a trick. You can stay at my sister's place, Jenny whispered in my ear. Just say yes, Kai. You deserve this. I cleared my throat.
I don't know. I guess so?
Brian clearly wanted to laugh, but knew better.
All right. The pay situation is embarrassing, but you'll have 20 minutes to light them all up with your magic.
Thank you, I whispered, a ghost of my former self already. I didn't know what else to say. A real show? In Boston, with a known band? Was I really fast-forwarding from the Porch House to the Paradise Rock Club?
Oh, look at the time. We really have to go now, unfortunately, Jenny said, throwing her arm around me and cross-shoulder carrying me away from the riptide of my social inadequacies.
I don't remember actually leaving the Porch House. Pretty sure I was drifting into another dimension. I do recall giving my doggy bag to the homeless woman outside store 24, who didn't seem very grateful after she looked inside. Rule number two, don't ask permission. I was used to pressure, not so much from peers, but definitely from my father. Father pressure. Kids in my class were easy to dismiss, but my dad's demands had always been tough to brush off. He pushed me to stick to school,
keep my head in the books instead of the clouds where I couldn't see the ground. I did well at school. Really well. But I also played piano every day, straight through the endless refrain of his discouragement from taking myself seriously as a musician. I was more practical than I wanted to be, maybe a byproduct of having such a no-nonsense father. So I tried to beat down the desire to live only for music, but it proved to be a weed that grew relentlessly, despite how many times I tried to rip it away. It persisted no matter how often I was told to keep my head down, stick to the books, choose a set career path. My family's house, a small split level built by my great-grandfather, looked even smaller at night. I smelled waffles as soon as I walked through the front door, my father's go-to meal at any time of day. But at night, the scent usually meant he'd been drinking. I knew it was probably a bad time to tell him I was asked to play a show in Boston at the Paradise. He wasn't exactly easygoing when he'd had a bit. I took my boots off with a sigh and walked down the creaky hallway toward the kitchen. He sat at the table in front of a tower of waffles with his reading glasses on. They made him look fragile, despite his sturdy carpenter's build. He seemed absorbed in the newspaper, but put it down when I opened the fridge. "Hey, Pops. How was the show?" he asked, looking me over with disapproval. I knew he especially hated my street bum chic thrift store corduroy jacket and absolutely anything with sparkles on it. That was my Pops. No frills, no fairy tales. I knew my deep, dark songs made him uncomfortable. It was probably for the best that he didn't attend shows. "It was fine. Where's your car?" "Damn thing died on me coming home from the store this afternoon. I had Tyler tow it." "You need a new car." "We need a lot of things, Kyla. Why don't you worry about getting into college and get a job in the meantime to help pitch in around here?" Eyes Wander had mentioned there was pay. Little pay, but still, it had to be more than the porch house paid me. It was an angle I hadn't considered before. "Well, what if my job was performing? Maybe getting regular gigs in Boston and stuff?" "Yeah, then maybe I'll get a job skating with Disney on Ice." I held my tongue and walked out of the kitchen, blinking back tears. It was bad enough my father wouldn't come to my shows, but he didn't have to flat out dismiss my ideas like that. His words stung like a sunburn. Well, forget asking him anything then. I hated having to lie, but he wasn't showing me any respect either. I'd say I was sleeping at Jenny's after the game, which was why she couldn't actually come with me to Boston. Against all odds, Jenny was a talented and committed cheerleader. Upstairs, I saw a light shining from under my parents' door, unusual for this time of night. I opened the door slowly. Mom was sitting up in bed, wearing a faded flannel nightgown. The goose-shaped nightstand lamp switched on next to her. The combination of radio jazz and the air perfumed by her favorite almond-scented lotion made the room feel cozy. In these first quiet moments, I almost forgot what I'd done to her. Who she was now. "Kai Kai," she said softly. "Hi, Mama. How are you?" "Sleepy," she said. "When I close my eyes, I see little puffy clouds with bears dancing on them. One of them told me to tell you something." She was such a wild card. I took a deep breath. "What's the word?" Mom frowned. "He said he would be watching out for you when the wolves from the west come sniffing around." "I'll keep that in mind," I said,
perching on the edge of the bed. That was a new one. Was Eyes Wander from California? It seemed likely, and made her comment even weirder. My mother grew more agitated, small wrinkles piling up on her delicate forehead.
You don't understand. You have to get out of here.
I fell back on her comforter and sighed. I know, Mom. I'm trying.
I don't want you to see what I'm going to turn into.
She grabbed my hand and gave me a startled, haunting look.
I can see it, practically feel it, and it's not good. I can't let it happen. You have to get out of here. Promise me.
The familiar claws of anxiety were churning inside. I thought it was okay to come say hi this late, but I should have known better. She'd been having more flashbacks lately, even though the accident that I caused had happened over 2 years ago. The hardest part was that she was confusing the flashbacks with premonitions. She was somehow convinced she kept seeing what was going to happen to her, to us. But for all the times I'd promised her I was leaving so that it wouldn't happen to me, to us, it was that much more heartbreaking, because I would do anything to go back and avoid that night too. But I knew we would never be able to dodge that chapter of our past. It had already been written in permanent ink, though it seemed she'd never grasp that. The best move was to distract her with a diversion. Otherwise, it was a matter of seconds before she propelled me out of the room to go pack my bags and pretend to move out. Again. Sometimes it was the only way to get her to calm down. I'd sit out in the garage until my dad got her to take some pills and fall asleep. Mama, guess what? I was offered a really cool gig tonight. The biggest one yet. I'm a little nervous about it. You could see the slow shift in her face as the tragedy of that night was replaced by the image of me playing piano to a large audience. I watched as her tiny frown wrinkles disappeared.
It's great you're playing out so much these days, she finally said. Maybe I'll be able to make a show soon. I'd love to hear you play.
It's okay, Mom. I know. She reached over and stroked my hair for a little while. The familiar tug of grief pulled at my mind, dragging it back to that day when everything changed. It was a blizzard, and I'd convinced her to let me drive. I'd said I needed to learn how to handle bad weather. The irony is sickening now. I hit a patch of black ice and slid off the road. I wasn't hurt, but Mom nearly died. She was laid up for months with a broken arm, 8 fractured ribs, and a shattered collarbone, eating painkillers and watching bad TV. When she was able to move around all right again, she tried to go back to work at the bakery, but ended up getting fired for sassing back to rude customers, something I personally found heroic. Left to her own devices at home, she bought a mower at a yard sale and began to mow people's lawns without asking. More than a dozen times, neighbors dropped by and asked her to stop. People even started calling her the crazy lawnmower lady behind her back and harassing my dad at work to get him to do something. We were so ashamed by it all that finally my dad sold the lawnmower and brought her to a psychiatrist. Dr. Reese hadn't been able to figure out exactly how to diagnose or handle her. It was a form of PTSD he hadn't seen before, he said. She baked a lot when she was in a certain calm state and almost seemed normal. Other times, she would have terrible waking nightmares and flashbacks, talk nonsense, and if you tried to talk her down, she would become so agitated she'd become another person entirely. Dr. Reese had made a joke about her being a psychological adventurer
who dabbled in all types of emotional disorders but couldn't commit to one. The situation turned my father's hair from black to gray in the span of 2 years. My mom would always be my first and biggest supporter, though. That made the guilt all the more crushing. I had to get out of there. My room was the usual amount of messy. I grabbed sweatpants off the floor and a ratty sweater I'd been using for a pillow. After washing my makeup off in the bathroom, I plucked my eyebrows for a little while, relishing the tiny pricks of pain with each tweeze. It helped blot out the ever-stinging sarcasm of my father. I knew my sad little family relied on me being around in the future to help out with the bills, but I really wanted to get out of there for good. I couldn't wait to go to college, if only to get away from my miserable parents. Not having to witness their misery every day was my real first priority in life. Of course, I'd only been allowed to apply to schools within a 50-mile radius, so I could come home to witness their misery, aka help out on the weekends, unless I got a job, thereby sacrificing all freedom. But now, another option began to form. An escape plan in the event that I didn't get a scholarship. I could get a job, any job, in Boston, move into my own place, play gigs on nights and weekends, force my dad to deal with it. My freedom could be closer than I thought. Rule number 3. Always do what scares you. When I stepped on stage at the Paradise, the jolt of adrenaline hit me like high-frequency feedback. My whole body felt electric scratchy as invisible lightning licked beneath my skin. The place was jammed up to the rafters. They told me that people sometimes show up early because of the weather, but I definitely hadn't expected to play for a full room as the opener for the opener during a snowstorm in Boston. It was at least 20 times the amount of people I had ever played for in my life, and my first time performing at a real venue. My first time performing on a grand piano, for that matter. My mouth became the desert. My tongue, a cactus that couldn't rest comfortably anywhere. Why did I want to be a musician again? Stop. I was here to prove I belonged here. That I could make it. Make it worth lying to my parents. Make it worth forcing myself under the alarmingly hot beam of a spotlight. The dim sea of silhouettes stood waiting. Eyes full of reflected light trained on me. Fear thundered into my ears, temporarily deafening me. I forced a thin smile, took a few tiny, weak breaths, and focused on the word Steinway written over the keys in gold lettering. I closed my eyes and was at home in the basement. Just me, playing to the old photos and posters on the walls. I finally felt my mind slip back into my body and reattach itself all the way through to my fingertips. I pressed a key by accident and my hands jumped back, the overreaction causing some laughter. I shook my head and produced an unnaturally high laugh at myself. No way I was going to speak into that microphone to babble an apology and tell them this was my first real show. Nope. That was not cool. There was nothing to do but launch headfirst into the opening song, begging my melodies to transport me and everyone in the crowd. Exposing my private poetry over piano chords was terrifying, and if any other performers thought different, they probably weren't writing the kind of songs I write. I didn't pause to explain anything before starting the next song. Just took a few breaths when I could. I led them through my lonely ballads and angsty bangers, being my own weird, plain-looking small-town girl in jeans and a t-shirt, because Jenny wasn't there to stop me. I sang my threadbare heart out, like my life depended on it. Everything had a level of urgency behind it. This was the only way I felt like me.
Performing was my mirror. The audience was kind. The piano sounded like a dream, and the microphone was hands down the best I'd ever used. The sound of my singing was so beautifully amplified that I hardly recognized my own voice. I grew more confident, hitting notes I didn't usually try for. I felt the attention press around me so powerfully that I burrowed deeper than usual into my songs. I basically blacked out on stage, which might be a good thing sometimes. The last piece was a newer song, so fresh in my mind that it was bursting with energy and begging to be played. "This last one's called Take Me Away," I said into the mic with a little bit more confidence. The crowd cheered encouragingly. The song was a dark, pleading ode to being stuck in an existence that didn't feel right and begging to be rescued by a miracle of fate. I threw in heated keystrokes, pushing the limits of the unfamiliar, pretending there was a whole five-piece band on stage backing me up. Maybe it was sloppy, but I didn't care. This last one was for me. The applause was overwhelming. I sat there for a minute, eyes closed and smiling, hair sticky around my face. I let the sound of their enthusiasm lift my heart back into its proper resting place. I had done it. I had exposed myself without bombing. The biggest thrill was realizing that this thing I'd built was a vessel with the power to take me far away from reality, if only for the length of a set. Rule number 4. No disclaimers. The night was as close to a perfect dream as I'd ever had. Eyes Wander was halfway through an incredible show, and I was tipsy and loving it. It wasn't like it was my first time drinking or anything, but it was certainly my first time drinking in public, surrounded by strangers who were all at least several years older than me. That was a separate thrill of its own. Brian had snagged me a wristband, and people kept offering me drinks and compliments. Jenny and I had done some drinking with her older sister's friends, so I thought I could handle it. But I felt adrift without my co-pilot by my side. I was also thoroughly amped up by all the newness of the night, which kind of zeroed me out to an even keel. I wasn't just some teenager in headlights. I was holding my own at one of the coolest venues in the Boston area.
"They don't call it the paradise for nothing," said a voice, as if inside my head.
The bartender, a short girl with ivy tattooed up her arm, put down a shot in front of me and grinned. The liquid was a bright red 5-star alarm.
"From an admirer," she added.
I looked confused, so she pointed down the bar, and there she was. Ruby Sky. The Ruby Sky I'd stared at in so many pictures. The lead singer of Glitter Tears, the rock star chick with violet hair and a single sparkly tear under her eye, and definitely the biggest celebrity I'd seen in person. She appeared to be smiling at me.
Me? Kyla Bell, unknown nobody from the middle of nowhere, Massachusetts?
Not a chance. I looked over my shoulder to be certain I wasn't about to make a fool out of myself before smiling back. She laughed and disappeared into the crowd. And just as soon as my heart got sent a flutter, it was deflated. I took the shot in my hands and rotated it on the bar, watching the multicolored lights dance in the fiery liquid, feeling the familiar burn of disappointment.
"Are you gonna drink that or stare at it?"
I turned, and there she was in all her wondrous alternative glory. Silver miniskirt, shiny boots, a fishnet long-sleeved shirt under a t-shirt of a cupcake making an evil face. "Sweet" written under it. Her purple hair looked almost black in the dim lights of the club. Her iconic rainbow glitter tear
twinkled in the lights. I was too swallowed up by her presence to speak.
Well, she asked, do I need to do one too?
I nodded. My tongue had apparently fallen into a coma, so I bit it to wake it up, wincing with pain. Ruby Sky laughed like this happened to her all the time, and maybe it did, because somehow the bartender knew to bring her another neon red shot. She picked it up and motioned for me to do the same. We clinked glasses and tossed them back together. I tried to respond as if it was something I did all the time, but it burned something awful, so I snorted and then coughed from the overwhelming cinnamon taste. Totally unslick. She was still laughing at me when I recovered. I think I just swallowed mouthwash, I croaked, feeling my stomach clench. Those were my first words to one of my idols. Ouch.
Cinnamon bombs, she said. I loved your set.
Again, I almost looked around me to see if she was talking to someone else. Had Ruby Sky given me a compliment? Given me a compliment on my music? This was surely a dream, if not for the slosh of gross cinnamon in my stomach. Wow, thanks. I'm totally a fan, I said.
Uh-oh, the floodgates were opening.
I have all your albums. You're one of my favorite. I halted there and cringed, struggling to stop the giddy little fangirl that was getting out. I'm sorry, I rocketed on. You've been a real inspiration to me. I've written piano parts to a ton of your songs. I hadn't expected that to come out, but at least it seemed cooler than revealing my love for screaming her lyrics into my hairbrush.
Oh, yeah?
She asked, way more interested than I'd expected. Yeah.
Well, you have to play them for me, she said.
Wow. Okay. Wait. Now?
Is there ever a better time?
She winked as she took my hand and held it tight. The thrill of her fingers clutching mine tickled every nerve in my body, even in places I'd never felt before. Forget music. Was this what being on drugs felt like? I floated behind her, as she cut fearlessly through the crowd and opened the door backstage. All at once, the music stopped and we were away from everyone, just Ruby Sky and me in an empty hallway. The cheering crowd sounded so far away as my heart became a heavy kick drum thudding in my ears. Ruby led me behind the stage to the area the grand piano had been stored. I immediately went to the bench and sat down. I was so nervous that standing felt awkward. Why could she possibly want to do this now? How was she possibly that interested in my interpretations of Glitter Tears' hits?
Why are you here? Was what I ended up blurting out.
I mean, I'm just surprised. Brian's a really good friend, she said.
I've known these guys for years. I'm in town for a record release event, and I love these divey venues.
Yeah, I said, even though to me, Paradise Rock Club was a palace. I thought she was brave for coming to this place, being part of the average crowd. People were probably too intimidated to approach her. Her eyes were so frosty, I felt deliciously chilled looking into them. She had high cheekbones, and her face was thin but not pointy, just delicate. The sparkles applied to her tattooed tear flashed under the overhead lights. She was hypnotically beautiful. It was hard not to stare. But Ruby Sky didn't seem to mind. She stared back, all confidence and clairvoyance, seeing right through me.
You don't have much experience, do you, Kyla?
What do you mean?
I stiffened up immediately. Then I relaxed my shoulders, reminded myself to keep cool. It was as honest an assessment as any, if only I could drop my defenses and desperation to seem older.
You're so self-conscious, as if no one's ever really seen you before.
I guess, I said at last. Maybe not. I mean, maybe not many have. I noticed it even when you were on stage. I want to know your story, she said. Where have you been? You don't fool me with your act of modest insignificance. I can tell you have a lot going on inside.
I felt my entire body blush, like it had just been stroked by the hand of a goddess. Still, I could not speak.
Play now, she commanded.
Okay.
I hesitated. Would I even remember my arrangements of her songs in this state?
I'm a little buzzed, just warning you. No disclaimers, she interrupted.
Let's get that straight up front. They're weak. Don't make excuses. Stand behind yourself and your work. Always.
I sat up like I'd been slapped.
Right, I agreed.
It was just that I'd never played for anyone while intoxicated before. I'll start with the part I wrote for Rumble, if that's okay.
I struggled out of my shyness, tried to forget Ruby's presence, and shut my eyes for a second. Even though the room smelled of spilled drinks and sweat, not musty laundry like my basement, even though I could hear the audience's muffled screams for another encore instead of the scuffling of vacuuming above me, I recalled my version of Glitter Tears' most popular ballad. It was one of those times when the pressure's so high that you don't think you can be what you want to be, but something inexplicable comes and takes over your body for you. She started to sing along right there next to me, and it shot chills down my back, almost making me mess up. Ruby Sky had a riveting rock voice, so sexy, raw, and powerful that it gave me the strength to finish. Someone started clapping as we wound our way out of the song.
Wow, Brian said. I see you two have met.
Hey, babe.
Ruby smiled and danced over to his side.
You guys were on fire tonight.
They embraced, and she gave him a kiss on the mouth. He looked extremely happy. His shirt was wet with sweat, and his eyes were flashing. I wondered how much of the set Ruby had actually watched. Brian swelled with pleasure at her words. I noticed he'd somehow gotten cuter, as if his body itself was trying to impress Ruby. Even the way he was standing was different. He'd looked straight into her eyes. She stared back. No trace of embarrassment or awkwardness, just a confident hold on her power over him.
So, Kyla, he began.
Oh, yeah, I've met Kyla.
Isn't she great? He said. I knew you'd love her.
I looked down at the ground, embarrassed to be referred to in the third person while in the room with them when they were clearly intimate, or had been, or were going to be very soon.
I'm going to take her on tour with me, Ruby said casually. Laughter exploded out of me. The notion was too ridiculous.
Then I stopped laughing, as I realized they were studying me. Ruby whispered something to Brian, and he nodded as if he was almost pained to admit something. I felt a flash of fear.
Well, Brian says you're of legal age to do what you want, Ruby said to me. So, why not?
Rule number 5. Let it go. I loved visiting Cambridge and felt at home among the colorful, scrappy street punks and quirky little shops in Harvard Square.
Jenny's older sister had lived there for a few years, so we stayed with her as often as we could and got to pretend to be city cats. When I walked around, I'd get nods from kids as if they knew me, and it was one of the only places my low-key, read gutter grunge style felt right. I loved exploring the tobacco shops with their strange smells and funny pipes, the spiritual shops full of crystals, tapestries, and tarot cards, the endless book and record stores. Harvard Square was an eclectic collection of cool stuff like nowhere else. If I'd been lucky enough to grow up in Cambridge, I was sure I'd make more sense to myself and everyone else. The Greenhouse coffee shop and restaurant was a diner with a tropical feel to it. Ashtrays on the tables and plants everywhere. Jenny and I had gone in for French fries and sodas a few times before. I felt way underprepared to meet Ruby's manager, Kevin. I wasn't sure what he was going to be screening me for, nor had I any clue what I was supposed to be saying or doing to win his approval. I could scarcely wrap my head around the situation myself. The word shabby popped into mind as I looked down at my faded, torn jeans, dark green flannel I'd had since the first year of high school, and homemade scarf my mother knit years ago. But there was nothing I could do. I'd had no time to prepare for this life-changing interview that had dropped into my lap the night before. I didn't have the cash for a new outfit. The amount they'd paid me out the night before was barely enough for a bus ticket home. And Jenny's sister was just as grungy a dresser as I was, so it was pointless to borrow anything from her. I was headed into the most important interview I'd ever had, and it was all I could do not to trip on my combat boots. Ruby and her manager were seated in the corner. They didn't see me approaching. The manager was sharply dressed and had piercing eyes, short cropped hair, and a close shave. His black collared shirt and crisp dark jeans made him look straight out of a fashion ad. Ruby looked as fresh and beautiful as ever. She gave me a bright and engaging look that unleashed excitement within my constricted chest, bubbling over my nervousness like hot springs to help ease the tension. Her manager turned to study me. "Hello," he finally said. We shook hands and I tried to put some firmness into it. "I'm Kevin Milton with Cypress Management." "Nice to meet you," I said. "I'm Kyla Bell."
"Sit down, Kyla," Ruby patted next to her on the booth.
I plopped down next to her in relief, breathing in her sweet honeysuckle vanilla scent and willing myself to be more confident. This was my golden ticket out of my sleepy hometown. I could not blow this. Kevin studied me. He had a chiseled jawline and was definitely the most intense man I'd met before. Did all music managers look like fierce, starving models? My stomach was tumbling on high, and I decided to only speak if spoken to first.
"Ruby's told me a lot about you," he began.
"But," she interjected, "there's obviously still a lot I don't know."
"Let's order before we get to that," Kevin said, waving his hand impatiently in the general direction of the staff. "I'm starving."
We looked over the menu as someone came to take our order. I wasn't hungry at all. Ruby ordered a house salad, so I did the same. She smiled encouragingly at me. Definitely the right choice. All I had to do was follow her lead, and I could probably be fine. Kevin ordered egg whites with a side of steamed broccoli. As soon as the waiter left, he checked his watch, pulled out his cell phone, and excused himself to make an urgent call. I was grateful to be alone with Ruby for a minute. She looked me over again. "I'm sorry," I said again after a moment. "These are the only clothes I have,"
Don't worry about it. I filled him in on the whole story. He knows you're as surprised as he is.
What did he say?
He's worried, but I think it'll be fine.
Her confidence was almost contagious, but pressure still pressed down hard. She couldn't possibly understand how much this would mean to me. If I had to stay home much longer, I would most certainly go insane. I bit the inside of my lip and tasted the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.